Good morning, everyone. And welcome to this chapel that recognizes and honors Women's History Month. On behalf of our president, Dr. Nancy Claire Pittman, we are delighted that you are here this week for classes. We are delighted that you are in this space for worship. Both you who are physically present and those of you who are worshiping with us through the live stream. We encourage you to be reflective throughout this day and the rest of the month on the lives of women. Welcome. Please join me in the call to worship. Our minds are disturbed by the incidents we hear. Oh, come, let us disturb others.
And recommit themselves to the Lord.
Oh, come, brothers and sisters, let us together celebrate the lives of women who have sacrificed their lives. Let us together stand in solidarity for the coming generations of women who need love, respect, and care.
Standing here wondering, which way to go? So much confusion in this world below. I've been suffering. Driven from door to door, standing here wondering, yeah, which way to go. The road lies in darkness. Lights are dim low. Where will it lead us? Oh, no one seems to know. There may be destruction, and it worries me so. Well, Lord, if you know me, come and show me which way to go. So standing here wondering. Which way to go? There's so much confusion. World below, I've been suffering from door to door. Standing here wondering. Which way to go? Ooh, to go.
Good morning. I'm here to walk us through a prayer of the people, but before I do, I would like to open this up for a time of joys and concerns as a community. We'd like to take turns sharing what the Spirit has placed on your heart. We will, in community, respond with, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. 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 And for those prayers who are in our hearts and not lifted up aloud, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. I now ask you to join me in a posture of prayer as I share the words of Sister Irina Kim Eubanks. God, who created us very good, every day is a day to celebrate the splendor, the wonder of all of us women. For all that we carry, water on our heads, babies in our wombs, the legacy of our ancestors, dreams for future generations, we ask for strength in our bones and love for our own frames. For all that we raise, the children of our villages, communities of resilience, resistant hands, defiant voices, we ask for the courage to keep asserting in a world that honors our being. For all that we bear, violence, both physical and emotional, injustices, both known and unknown, the inescapable weight of misogyny, the trauma of generations, we ask for an end to the forces that tear and the force of love to repair. For all that we break, stubborn glass ceilings, sexist expectations, long-held silences, systems that dehumanize, we ask for an unwavering sense of worth and new structures that can house all of who we are. For all that we continue to fight for. Equal pay, reproductive rights, queer and trans visibility, migrant justice, we ask for new weapons to be forged in divine wisdom for the battles ahead. And for all that we are, resilient, powerful, loving, hospitable, caring, daring, beautiful, valuable, generous, we ask for fullness of joy and gladness in our existence. Grant women around the world reminders this day of our immeasurable worth, the divine image within us. And amid the forces that make us forget, help us remember that our bodies are for thriving, our stories are for telling, and our presence is resistance in a world that tries to erase us every day. Amen. And now, a word of scripture from Genesis chapter 2, verses 18 through 23. Then the Lord God said, "It is not good that the man should be alone. I will make him a helper as his partner." So out of the ground, the Lord God formed every animal of the field and every bird of the air and brought them to the man to see what he would call them. And whatever the man called every living creature, that was its name. The man gave names to all the cattle and to the birds of the air and to every animal of the field. But for the man, there was not found a helper as his partner. So the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon the man, and he slept. Then he took one of his ribs, closed it up in place with flesh. The rib that the Lord God had taken from the man, God made into a woman and brought her to the man. The man said, "This at last is bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. This one shall be called woman, for out of man this was taken." This is the word of God for God's people.
Is black. My arms are long. My hair is woolly. My back is strong. Strong enough to take the pain. Inflicted again and again. What do they call me? My name is Aunt Sarah. My name is Aunt Sarah. Aunt Sarah. Skin is yellow. My hair is long. Between two worlds, I do belong. My father was rich and white. He forced my mother late. What do they call me? My name is Sophronia. My name is Sophronia. My skin is tan. My hair is fine. My hips invite you. My mouth like wine. Whose little girl am I? Anyone who has money to buy. What do they call me? My name is Sweet Thing. My name is Sweet Thing.
May the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. I'd like to share with you from the theme, Four Womanist Attitudes for Ministry. Four Womanist Attitudes for Ministry. As we are well aware, March is Women's History Month. During this month, we celebrate, commemorate, learn about, and learn from the lived experiences of women. We'll hear the stories of legendary history makers and of women who have changed lives without ever achieving notoriety. We'll learn about the faithful, courageous, named and unnamed women who faced adversity and fought against oppression. Given this fact, you are no doubt challenging the selection of Genesis 2 as a text for a worship that celebrates Women's History Month. This text, however, in many ways represents how women's lives have been interpreted by a male-dominated society. While the text may declare human beings are created in the image of God, Adam names Adamah. Naming exercises power over someone. So Adam names and defines his world. In my early formation, Dr. Rosemary Ruther, renowned feminist theologian, described these early narratives as male rites of passage stories. So understanding that, we see Adam, we see him locating himself in his world. And his outlook on the world. We see him organizing the world and making himself the center of his universe. And as we say, the rest is his story. Given these facts, you are no doubt asking yourselves, then why am I a preacher during Women's History Month? My answer. Most of us are acquainted with the importance of intersectionality. My intersectional approach appeals to womanist discourse. It's an approach that identifies the tri-dimensional oppressions of race, class, and gender as interlocutors, and they must all three be engaged. If the dismantling of systemic oppression is to be realized, this means that I, as a man, must be committed to women's and others' liberation initiatives. As a result of my commitments, many womanists identify me as a collaborator and womanist brother. So today, as an expression of my commitment to participate in telling her story, as my mother's son and as a man who wears womanist purple, hear me. And yes, Phillips has chosen purple as its new color, but I was wearing purple as a womanist man long before I got to Phillips, and Phillips made that change. One approach to beginning a discussion on her story is through the arts. Literature and music have been important art forms for conveying and experiencing and opening up conversations on her story. Looking back, I can still hear Helen Reddy, "I am strong, I am invincible, I am woman." And who can forget the national anthem sung by Katie Lang, "Constant Craving Has Always Been"? Yet older than both of these was Nina Simone's Four Women. Simone's artistry presented the power, passion, the promise, and the problems of Black embodiment. In the age of Black consciousness and Black women's cultural revolution, Simone called, dare I say, she even conjured the liberation spirit of African-American womanhood and the liberation of the Black community. You see, when you compare the tenets of womanism to Simone's activism, you discover that Simone is what Joanne Terrell identifies as a proto-womanist. Reaching back to the experiences of Black women during slavery and characterizing the experiences of African American women through the 1960s, Simone introduces four different women that she ultimately described as four different ways American society sees Black womanhood. Each woman described as having a different skin color, which represent different experiences and personalities, is called by a certain name. Aunt Sarah, Black. Sophronia, Yellow. Sweet Thing, Tan. And Peaches, Brown. In this song, Simone declares American slavery has made an indelible imprint upon the bodies of Black women, and America therefore interacts with Black women fundamentally out of these four images of Black womanhood. These four women together speak of an inherited legacy of suffering and survival. From this, Simone is saying America judges Black women through their physical attributes, names them, and labels their attitudes for life. By describing and defining the physical attributes and attitudes of Black women, America says where Black women can and cannot go, what Black women can and cannot do. Ultimately, America says exactly what anyone can do to Black women. The Bible is filled with stories of named and unnamed women whose lives has been used to present varying images of womanhood and what it means for women to be faithful to God. The overwhelming number of these stories tend to sum up women in terms of their bodily experiences within a male-dominated society. I'm suggesting today that the four archetypes introduced by Simone can be seen as attitudes and attributes for womanist ministry. Archetypes are recurring symbols that point to what is enduring and revelatory. Aunt Sarah, Sophronia, Sweet Thing, and Peaches as four womanist attitudes can be likened to the biblical characters of Ruth, Esther, Mary the Magdalene, and Deborah. Ruth, a Moabite, married a young man from Bethlehem who was caring for his mother. After Ruth's husband died, she considered it her loving duty to take care of her mother-in-law, Naomi. We know well her statement to Naomi, "Entreat me not to leave you. Where you go, I go. Where you stay, I stay. Your people, my people, and your God, my God." As an attitude for ministry, remember God is a mother to the motherless. Cling to God and go wherever God leads you. Do whatever God instructs. Your survival and the survival of God's people is in your hands. Esther, a Jewish girl during the exile, saved the Jews in Persia. The story begins by her passing as a Persian, caught between two worlds. In the course of events, she became queen in Persia, but she was passing when the crown was placed upon her head, living the imitation of life. When her people faced with extermination, her uncle declared she must do something to save the people, suggesting perhaps she became queen for such a time as that, for that very reason. After this, We know well her statement. I will go to the king, and if I perish, I perish. Through her courage and capacity to make the system work for her, Esther became a savior of the people. As an attitude for ministry, accept the power, privilege, and authority of your calling. Use your office to save the people from social and political annihilation. Mary Magdalene, a woman who had 7 demons cast out of her, and she became a follower of Jesus. With no husband, no children, or home, her character was seen as disreputable. Once her life was changed by Jesus, she faithfully followed him throughout his ministry. When his chosen disciples hid in fear after his arrest, she was with Jesus to the end as he suffered on the cross. She's recorded as the first to see and have conversation with him in the garden after his resurrection. As an attitude for ministry, be a courageous preacher of the gospel of Jesus. When they call you everything but a child of God, remember Mary Magdalene, the one who once was possessed and had a disreputable reputation as a woman, was the first to preach the resurrection, even to the disciples of Jesus. She didn't just hear Jesus died, she witnessed his death. She didn't just hear he was alive again, she walked and talked with him. Preach to restore the people to life. Deborah, the fourth judge in the land of promise, was a prophet and warrior led by the Spirit of God. Before there was a king to rule over the land, God established judges to lead and govern the people, able to hear and discern the voice of God. Deborah declared righteous judgment upon the people while seated beneath her palm tree. She fearlessly called the people to be liberated from oppression. It was Deborah who directed Barak to go to war to end the evil among the people. Barak knew God was with Deborah, so he declared, "If you go with me, I'll go. If you don't go with me, I will not go." Deborah's presence at the battle was the symbolic presence of Almighty God. As an attitude for ministry, give good and wise counsel to the people. When they come to you burning with anger, remain seated beneath the shade of your palm tree to discern the will of God for their lives. Most of all, don't be afraid to go to war, always remembering that the battle is not yours, it's the Lord's. America and the church have strong opinions about what women can and cannot do in leadership. Churches are still sexist and misogynistic and quick to invoke Paul to declare women should keep silent in the church. After that, it's not unusual for the church to point to Proverbs and say, Just be a virtuous woman. Cook in the kitchen and sell the dinners. That's the ministry the Lord has blessed you with, because God never called a woman to preach, is what they'll say. Instead of being named by men, speak your own name and exercise your gifts of the Spirit for ministry. The word of the Lord.
We shall not bow down to
racism.
We shall not bow down to
injustice.
We shall not bow down to
exploitation.
Oh, what's he gonna do?
I'm gonna stand.
I'm gonna stand.
I'm gonna stand.
I'm gonna stand. I'm gonna stand. Just can't tolerate no
racism.
No, I just can't tolerate
injustice.
No, I just can't tolerate no
exploitation.
What you gonna do?
I'm gonna stay.
For our benediction, I share with you a womanist blessing that I wrote and presented to my womanist friends for them to share during a gathering of the womanist religious studies scholars. For too many centuries, we have taken her or taken from her without asking. We've abused her without apology. We've called her outrageousness crazy. We've called her audaciousness inappropriately loud. We've called her courageousness foolish. Yet she continues to give and forgive. May we all learn from her and accept her as gift. May we go forth loving music, loving dance, loving moon and sun, loving spirit, food, and roundness. May we go forth loving the love at the end of the struggle. May we go forth seeing, feeling, knowing outrageous, audacious, courageous love. Amen.